Welcome to this special celebration and live stream from the Parliament House of Victoria. And happy International Day of Women and Girls in Science. How do we feel about that, folks? Yeah. Excited to be here. My name is Natasha Mitchell. I'm a science journalist, a radio presenter and podcaster, and I trained originally as an engineer, so I guess I'm one example of all the pathways that life can take when you train in science. I am especially excited that we have some high school students in the room with us today, so thank you for giving up your Saturday to talk about girls and women in science. Thrilled that you're here. I want to acknowledge that we are on this land, this place of the first scientists. Aboriginal science is this land's foundational science. It is this land's foundational knowledge, and it is ever evolving. And I hope that we can be guided by it, we can be sensitive to it, and to the knowledge of elders and emerging leaders from all time. And if you are joining us on the live stream, a very special welcome to you. We would love your participation in this event. We want to know that you're joining us. Perhaps you'd like to post in the comments section what Aboriginal lands you're joining us from today, but we particularly also want to hear from you with questions and comments that are relevant to the discussion and to our four fantastic panellists today. So don't be shy, please post your comments. And of course, I'm going to be coming to you in the room too for your questions throughout. We'll have a bit of a discussion and then I'll open up your mics and we'd love to hear your questions and comments too to really inform and guide the discussion. So I just urge those who are in the beautiful chamber here at Parliament House to not be shy as well with your questions and thoughts today. Also, big thanks to the incredible collaboration of our hosts. We are being hosted today by the Royal Society of Victoria, the Parliament of Victoria, Victorian Parliamentarians for STEMM, which I'm very encouraged to know exists, the Commissioner for Environmental Sustainability Victoria, and Inspiring Victoria. Thank you so much for working together to make this special event possible and for all the work that you do in celebrating and supporting girls and women in STEMM. Well, to welcome us, before I introduce our incredible speakers, we have Dr. Tim Reid. Tim Reid, MP, Member for Brunswick in the Legislative Assembly. He's a dad, he's a doctor, he's a medical researcher, and he also happens to be Chair of Victorian Parliamentarians for STEMM. Thank you so much, Tim.
Thank you, Natasha. And welcome, everybody, to the red velour chairs of the Legislative Council. For those online, this is a particularly ornate chamber, nothing like the plain chamber I normally sit in, with as much red and gold as you can cope with, and then a bit more, and cherubs and unicorns and everything you need for a serious discussion on science, I reckon. And just to reassure everybody that there's no speaker to evict you from the chamber if you say the wrong thing. So when it comes to question time, ask the hard ones, and unlike the normal proceedings of Parliament, you can expect to get, I would hope, an answer that's relevant and concise. And there'll be no need to resort to the standing orders. But I'm really looking forward to hearing the comments from our distinguished guests. This event is part of work that is done periodically by the Parliament of Victoria to work with and engage with the science community along with the Royal Society of Victoria. And thank you very much to the staff from Parliament and the Royal Society for your efforts in bringing this event about. I'm really keen to hear ideas and solutions. As an MP, I can't be expert on all the topics and all the problems that are out there that need to be solved, but what I can do is perhaps offer comments and suggestions as to how to get your ideas to fix the problem into policy. And I'm keen to hear some of those ideas today, and I'm keen to reflect on how you might be able to turn those into action. I'm conscious of the fact that Victoria's public schools are still not as well funded as virtually any other state bar South Australia. So that's clearly one area where we have more work to do. But I know there's a lot more to this than that. So thank you, and back to you, Natasha.
Dr. Tim Reed, thank you so much. And the good thing is that girls and women have all the solutions, especially scientific solutions, and that's what we're here to discuss today. And we are here to discuss the joys of being in science fields, in whatever skin you're in. For example, I'm a science journalist and radio presenter, and I've used my science training every day in that role, and I'm sure my panellists will share similar things. So the joys, but also the challenges. You know, why don't we see more girls choosing maths and science at school, at university? Why do people decide after all this incredible training that they receive that perhaps science, engineering, technology, maths, medicine might not be for them after all, and they decide to do sort of career shifts in midlife? We're kind of curious about unpacking some of those things too. But we also want to talk about the revolution that's underway, and particularly in Australia, there's some fantastic work that's happening to change science. We're not talking about changing girls and women. We want to talk about changing scientific culture and practice to fully embrace the diversity of talent that's available to them, especially girls and women and non-binary people. So to welcome our special guests, I'm so excited to have these four women here today. We have Associate Professor Sophie Adams. She's Medical Director of the Mental Health Division at Austin Health, and she's a consultant psychiatrist. She's also been involved in a really fantastic initiative called Homeward Bound, which focuses on encouraging women in the sciences to join a leadership program, and part of that, they go to Antarctica. So, yeah, I'm rather jealous that she got to do that. We have Professor Madhu Bhaskaran. She's an engineer. She's co-chair of a network that's just absolutely fantastic in Australia called Women in STEM Australia. And she co-leads here in Melbourne at RMIT the Functional Materials and Microsystems Research Group. Now, it's impossible to summarise the range of work that she does, but one cool thing that stands out for me is that she's involved in developing stretchable, skin-like electronic devices for better healthcare. And that's just one thing she's doing of probably about 1,000 things. Thank you so much for joining us. We have Dr. Marguerite, better known to many of us as Maggie Evans-Galea. She is Director of STEM Career Strategy with the Australian Academy of Technology and Engineering. She was a former co-chair of Women in STEM Australia. And before that, she was also leading research in gene therapy and cell science, both here and in America. So she's got, you know, multiple hats. But she is a genuine revolutionary. She really established Women in STEM Australia and that movement in Australia. So I'm very excited to have Maggie with us today. And from New South Wales, we have Dr. Isabelle Kingsley, who works with a fantastic office called the Office of the Women in STEM Ambassador. She'll probably tell you more about that, but she's their research associate. And she's doing absolutely fundamental work, looking at the barriers how we dismantle barriers for girls and women who want to enter science, technology, engineering, maths and medicine fields. More importantly, she's measuring all those initiatives. You know, if you're at high school, you've probably been party to some of these amazing initiatives around women in STEM and girls in STEM. What's working and what's not? And she's a former school teacher and award-winning museum curator and educator. Welcome.
Thank you.
So good to have you. And I should acknowledge that they are all, in one way or another, either mothers or co-parents as well. So they're inspiring the next generation, both at home but also in the wider world. Now, we want your questions, Facebook audience, so get posting, and I'll come to you all for questions too. Let's start with, I want to know what pulled you into the sciences. What was it that seduced you with the joys and excitements? And also, what do you love about being connected to science fields? Sophie.
Oh, wow, that's such a big question. I was about to say, I as a child, I like fairy tales, and how does that sync with science is what I'm thinking. I just really want to understand everything about the world. And as a small child, I looked at it and I couldn't control it and I didn't know what was going on. I had my own challenges and I just wanted to know things. And that kind of led inevitably, I think, to science. And I think we forget the curiosity and the creativity that comes with science, that is so much a core part of the process, and think about it as this really analytical thing. But for me, it comes from my right brain. It comes from the joy of learning things.
And as a psychiatrist, you're getting to understand the complexity of the human mind, which is just an incredible thing to be able to do.
A huge gift, absolutely a massive privilege, and one that, you know, you sort of forget that you have sometimes. Mm. But also my role in a leadership way is about understanding systems and people and community, and so you get to kind of weave those ideas together. Makes for a very rich life and a very rich workplace.
Maggie, what about you? You had a very long and distinguished career in gene therapy and cell science, and now working in this revolutionary way to really mobilise industry and education around equity initiatives to get more girls and women into science and to keep them there. What drew you in to the world of science?
Originally, I'd say curiosity and creativity as well. I was one of those little kids that loved nature and getting really muddy and going down to the pond, and I'd always be asking why. And my mum would say, go find out for yourself, look it up. And so that just started me on a natural find the evidence kind of journey, and it just never stopped. And in high school, I loved music and science, and I couldn't decide between the two, so I did 2 degrees. And then halfway through, I decided science is the pathway.
Did you do a music degree as well?
I did. Oh, I'm awesome. A clarinet player, and kudos to anyone who's a musician in the room. There you go.
Often related, though, aren't they? Music.
Well,
and
it's that creative space, but also music is quite analytical in its way. It has a lot of rhythm, and the beauty of both is there. And to me, that's a powerful thing, where I recognise the arts and the sciences have so much in common, really, fundamentally. So I think we should constantly be coming together. But I chose science as the career because it was a logical choice partway through university. A very difficult choice. I really did love both. And, you know, I had fallen in love with the University of Queensland from since I was a kid. It was this awe-inspiring place for a North Queenslander from regional Mackay. And I was so excited to be there. I pursued a PhD at the University of New South Wales and just never stopped. I just kept learning. It was just that constant learning.
Did you feel that you could fully express your creative self as a scientist? Because science, we don't have this conversation enough, but science is fundamentally creative.
Absolutely, and it's the creativity of it that's so exciting, right? That's why so many people stay in research, because you're constantly asking questions and developing projects and ideas and aims and goals. What shall we take, you know, where shall we go next with this particular type of research? It's more of a best, isn't it? And you craft all these grants that are basically a story of creativity and where you want to go.
But you sort of get to look into
you
the world
back
and go,
it up. Yeah.
Well, how do I work out what that is?
Exactly.
What does that mean?
And that's when you ask the right questions, right? And that's what's so exciting. I do exactly the same thing now. And so in a completely different career, where I'm all about advocacy and developing policy, education, STEM workforce, skills, it all talks to the same skills, and I bring all that critical thinking, problem solving, creativity, grant writing. There's so much grant writing. But it's fun, you know, and that's what gives me a buzz. I'm happy to be up very late at night writing and tag teaming with someone to bounce those ideas, and that's what's really fun. You get to do it with other people, you get to do it with young people. That's so fun because they ask different questions. And that, to me, is really exciting. So for me, it's the STEM sector is like a brain. I use this analogy with my team a lot. And we want to connect all the neurons. We want to connect all the pathways, the industry, the academia, the research, the business, the diagnostics, the people, the public.
Yeah.
We've got to bring it all together.
I'm going to come back to you
because
I want
to
understand.
That, to me, is very exciting.
I do want to understand why you left research as such, why you stopped doing gene therapy and cell research, but that's an interesting discussion to have.
Yep.
Madhu, what about you? What pulled you into the world of engineering?
I did my undergraduate back in India, and it's a very different space to here, and which took me a while to kind of understand. Most people in India, I don't know, the aspirations or the expectations of you are that you're either a doctor or an engineer. Uh-huh. So, you know, you don't have much choices. if you choose to be a ballet dancer or a sports person, I really feel for you because your barriers are so much more than probably the barriers thrown in the middle of a STEM person over here. So for me, it was only a matter of figuring out, is it a doctor or an engineer? And if it's an engineer, what kind of engineer am I going to be? Now, my parents are medical doctors, which meant I will not become a medical doctor. It meant I'll become an engineer, as most kids do, and run in the opposite direction. I grew up in the 80s and 90s, and I was growing up at a time when, you know, the telephones were becoming smaller and smaller. So, you know, from having those corded phones where you had to have those conversations, to having cordless phones, to having mobile phones, it just was fascinating to see how electronics can become smaller and smaller and smaller, but you're adding more and more functionality as you keep going along. So I think that's what kind of inspired me to go into the direction of what's electronics engineering, what does it take to be an electronics engineer, and how do you keep, you know, pushing the boundaries and making things smaller and still keeping them more and more functional.
So what sorts of things are you designing and developing? I talked about these stretchable electronic devices. It's interesting you've come back to work in the health space. Yep. So, oh, yeah. You know, you can't escape your parenting. But what sorts of things are you doing? Just give us a sort of tangible sense of the microelectronics and nanomaterials that you're working with.
So a lot of what I do are what we call wearables or neurables or point-of-care diagnostics. So it's electronics which you can wear on your skin or which you can wear on your clothes or it's in the environment close to you and you don't really feel it, but it's still collecting information which is vital for you, either about yourself or about the environment close to you. So it could be wearables which are picking up your skin temperature, your ECG parameters, your oxymetry, yes. Mine are more skin-like, you won't feel yourself wearing them. That's the thing. And it's also things which you can put in mattress protectors, for instance. So some of the tech which we develop with companies are where we put them on mattress protectors to identify as a person in bed, what's their position, what's their posture. And that is actually trialing on in aged care homes right now to understand and prevent falls from happening during the course of the night. We also have technology which goes under your eye to, you know, prevent or alleviate the symptoms of dry eye disease. So just a variety of technologies which can, you know, just help you make better decisions about yourself and have a better understanding of your health.
And what's interesting about your approach is that you work very closely with companies and manufacturers and the university. So you're constantly probing what the needs are out there, what needs you can meet as an engineer.
And that's literally a dream come true because you always do research, you do fundamental research. Like Maggie said, I did a PhD, I was doing research in the lab. But I think as an engineer, you just want to see that technology leave the lab and make its way into the real life. And I can't do that by myself.
And change lives.
Absolutely, and I need to do that in collaboration. And for me, it's those collaborative relationships I have with the industry partners, with the manufacturing partners. And there's an aspect of arts to it as well. So we collaborate a lot with design partners to, you know, how do you design a better wearable which is more user-friendly, which people wouldn't mind using as much as something which is clunky or ugly looking. So it's a collaboration, which again brings in a lot of innovation into the piece.
Lots of relationships.
Absolutely.
And friendships and collaborations, creative or otherwise. Yeah, fantastic. Dr. Isabelle Kingsley, what about you? What pulled you into the world of STEM? I first met you and you were running incredible events and I got to be involved in some of them at the Powerhouse Museum of Arts and Sciences in Sydney.
I was a teacher, then I was a museum educator. So I was doing education. And I was working on this really amazing education program that relates to the search for life on Mars and the origins of life. And I got to go on this amazing field trip out in the Pilbara in Western Australia, in the desert. And I went there with geologists, biologists, astronomers, to really investigate this question of, like, where did we come from? And I just thought that it was, I didn't realize, even though I had a science degree and I was a science teacher, I didn't realize how creative and collaborative and just so exciting science was. And I came back from that field trip and I said, tag me in, like, I'm in. I want to do this. So I jumped in and started doing a PhD, and now here I am.
What did you do your PhD in?
I was really curious to find out if the education programs that I was creating were actually how they were changing people's way of thinking about things, about science. So I was just asking a lot of questions. Mm. Again, it came down to questions. Mm. I was asking a lot of questions about, how did this change? How did, what about this? What about that? Does this work better than that? And so the person I was working with at the time said, "Why? I think you're a little bit of a researcher. Like you're a scientist and you don't know it." So how it started.
Fantastic. And I love the fact that it took getting into the hot red desert for you to make that really deep connection, because I think we need to be reminded that science happens outside of classrooms and it happens outside of exams, and it's a whole world of doing and possibility. It's not what we experience at school. And so I did want to ask, why does the world right now, do you think, need girls and women in science and related fields? What is it about the challenges of the moment that we're living in, and we know what they are, that means that girls and women need to be part of this conversation and really absorbing this knowledge base, starting to understand how science can be a useful tool? Sophie.
Okay, so Homeward Bound has a whole thing about this, mm-hmm. And why women now and why women for change and sustainability. And, I think it is really true that although I would argue we're gender socialised to lead in certain ways, that I think women have certain leadership advantages, or at least a different way of doing leadership that can create more diverse teams, be more inclusive, be more future focused, and perhaps be a bit more collaborative. Not that that is the sole province of women, but that the way we have lived our lives, our lived experience, and the extra hurdles that we've overcome have forced us to learn some of these skills and the skills of influence rather than sort of a command and control kind of leadership style.
Interesting.
And if we can add in that different approach to the big, complex, wicked problems of our time.
Like climate change.
Like climate change. But, there's so many overlapping ones, aren't there? Then maybe you get that traction, that little bit of movement, that the diversity injection, which allows us to think differently and rethink through how we're, what we're doing as human beings on this planet. And, it is just women, Homeward Bound, but we're so proactively looking to increase diversity in all ways. And one day it won't matter what your gender is, or, the way that you think, or, whether you've got a disability of any form. We're going to celebrate people for what they bring. And there are a million different ways to think in the world. And let's hear them all before we make our decisions, because someone else might just have had a really good idea.
Yeah, yay for that. And diversity, I'm really loving the questions that are coming in on Facebook, so I'm actually going to throw a question at you. Anita asks on the Parliament of Victoria Facebook, thank you so much, Anita, how can we elevate the world's diverse scientists so that they stay in the sector and have fulfilling careers and, importantly, enhance a career that has longevity and stability? Epic question. But the question is about diversity and how we actually build diversity of life experience, of gender, culture, sexuality, age, socioeconomic status, where we've grown up, what our context was. How do we build that? I know this is something, Madhu, that you're very passionate about. This is not just a conversation about women and girls in STEM. For you, there's this concept of intersectionality, which is also about saying, let's talk about women, let's talk about culture, let's talk about diversity.
Thank you again for that question, and absolutely true about the intersectionality piece, right? Because sometimes we just tend to band all the problems as one, or we just go for a one-size-fits-all model. But if anything, the last decade of focusing on gender diversity has taught us is all women are not the same. And we all have very different kind of challenges coming into science or STEM. My entry into STEM, like I spoke about earlier, was probably a lot easier than it is for some people over here. But for me, it's the career growth, which is probably a lot harder. And especially being a migrant woman in a country where you don't have the family support, you don't have the friends to support you, to support your growing family, the challenges are very different. Mm-hmm. So that's one of the leaky pipeline. When you talk about leaky pipeline, that's one of the leakiest of the pipelines, where you find a lot of women leaving because there's just not enough support for them to leave and then to come back and to establish themselves all over again. It's a lot harder in academia because research never stops. The world keeps going research-wise. And so, it's even harder to come back, and your PhD students now know more than you than what you did 6 months ago, so you're catching up on that as well. It's a lot harder, and I'm glad in the last 10 years we've come with a better understanding on those kind of aspects of it. Going back to, you know, what you said, it's critical to be maintain that diversity piece, and for me, diversity clearly goes beyond gender. The other piece which I really love is somewhere I find that all the efforts which we are putting in, it kind of comes back to rest on the shoulders of women. So the and I don't know, it's like a workplace thing. The minute there's somewhere, there's a committee or something which is being formed on equity or diversity or inclusion or any of those
words.
Look
at the woman to do it.
Look at the women and you go, oh, you look like you're capable of leading this. Why don't you lead this piece?
Yet another thing to lead.
And I know we're fighting for representation and we're fighting to be on the right tables and for the right decisions to be made. But this is a people's problem. It's not a women's problem. So, and I'm really hoping it starts moving in that direction where everyone takes responsibility for it and everyone, you know, channels it and propels it in that direction rather than it again falling back on the shoulders or hands of women to, you know, make that change.
People have been talking about problems. I'm going to come back to this concept of a problem in a moment. But Maggie, do you think that your life experience as a woman shaped how you did science, brought something unique to science? Because often there's this conversation, well, talking about girls and women in STEM is important because women are 50% of the population, and so we need to have 50% of people in science reflecting that proportion of the population. I always think that's a really, it's okay to say that, it makes sense, but for me I'm more interested in, well, why does science need women in it and girls in it? Is it something that, do we bring something unique by virtue of our life experience and our insights?
Absolutely. And to me, you know, today is actually all about the UN's sustainability development goals. And climate change is by far the most urgent. And that's obviously a very big focus for Homeward Bound. But it's also the number one policy priority for almost every academy. Somehow we have to address that urgently. That's a people's problem. That's a planetary problem. And it requires every single idea on the table. We need Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander ideas on the table. We need culturally and linguistically diverse ideas on the table. We have the most refugees on the planet right now in this moment. We have just gone through a pandemic, and that has set equity and diversity back. And when you think about diversity and inclusion, yes, we tend to think about our backgrounds as individuals and our lived experience. And certainly I brought that to the table as a scientist, I have no doubt. I was in a single parent situation where a woman raised me. I have no doubt she was my best mentor and still is. But at the end of the day, let's think bigger. Let's think about the diversity of the ideas that are required to solve a problem, the diversity of the research that is required to solve the problem, the diversity of collaborations across sectors, across individuals, across people, across professions. We need all of that to solve these really major issues that we're going to face. Yes, it's the right thing to do. Yes, it's the best thing to do because we provide role models for our students. We give hope to the next generation about future careers and their pathway within that. And we want to ensure that any girl or woman or person who wants to lead has that opportunity. So to me, it's all about ideas at the end of the table and who's around that table. And because we've been in a white Caucasian male dominated life in every sector, law, economics, you
name it. Including the corridors of power.
The corridors of power, it is a different style of thinking and way of living purely because of societal culture. But microcosms of the same culture occur within organisations. Microcosms are much easier to shift. And if we really embrace it and work together to do that, I really believe that change is coming. There are microcosms. I know at RMIT there's little portions where it's moving. I know at WEHI, Walter and Eliza Hall Institute, there's
Medical portions. Research Institute.
Yeah, there's portions where it's moving. And that to me is really promising. I speak to women in the sector. They feel it if they're involved in the higher level conversations. if they're at the coal face of research or the coal face of industry, then they're not feeling it as much. So that's the hard part, is actually getting what's happening up here filtering all the way down to the students at school.
You need women in leadership roles in all sorts of environments, including science environments. Regina asks, what are the views of the panel in regard, and this is on the Parliament of Victoria Facebook page, so thank you to our live stream audience who are posting questions there, either on the Parliament of Victoria Facebook page. We're also streaming on the Royal Society of Victoria page. You can post questions there as well. We're keeping an eye on it all. I have eyes everywhere. and we're going to come to you in the room shortly. But Regina asks, what are the views of the panel in regards to balancing life stages and pressure with a successful career in a STEM profession? Now, I'm going to come to you, Isabelle, about that, because you've got your finger on all the data. And I think we need to paint a picture of some of the numbers here, because it offers us a picture of where the successes are, but also where some of the challenges are for girls and women who pick science careers. So paint a quick picture of us from, say, a life stage picture from primary school. You know, when we first get enthused about science at school, we have a great primary school teacher who's inspiring us about nature and the body and the world, and then we move into high school, and then we go to maybe university or TAFE, or we take other paths. But what's happening for women in science?
Okay, so imagine you're plumbing, okay, a big pipe, and over here you are in elementary school and primary school, and you're going through like water. There's a lot of girls who are just loving science at that age. We're all very curious, and that's, you know, that's, there's a lot of girls kind of loving science. And then they go through high school, and a few, there's a little bit of a hole in it, like drip, drip, drip out. Some of the girls drip out. Because when you get to high school, a lot of the times you start learning science by just reading facts, remembering facts, taking an exam, and that's just really boring. And you don't actually get to really do science and get to experience all the wonderful things that we've been talking about, that creativity, that that innovation, that collaboration that kind of leaks, that kind of falls off. So you lose some girls there. And then you go into university, and it gets even worse with more exams and stuff like that. You start losing.
Some of
girls.
Us like exams.
But it's still pretty even, like 50-50 almost.
You got to learn stuff and then really consolidate your knowledge about it. It's kind of satisfying.
Well, yeah, I have to admit, I kind of liked exams. Yeah. So I knew how to study and regurgitate those facts. But it's right about there at, you know, the end of university when you go into things like, you know, postgraduate studies or into the workplace, that then more and more girls start, there's more holes in that pipe, and more girls start leaking out. So
Making active choices, though.
They're making choices.
To pursue other directions. So I'll be interested to unpack that with all of you, actually, because I know you've all had to make those choices.
Yeah, yes and no. That's my answer.
Yeah,
to that.
So but there's choices and there's, like, not choices. So,
exactly. Yeah.
So you get into the workplace and you've got this awesome job that you love, but all of a sudden these challenges come up. And there are a lot more challenges for the women and non-binary and other marginalized groups that come into play that eventually just make it really hard to kind of stay in those science careers and those science jobs. And so women just...
Which aren't unique to science, I have to say.
They aren't.
These are just workforce issues that all women and non-binary people experience in all sorts of different workplaces.
Like, for example, one example is, you know, when women start having children, you have to, you know, you have a child and you take parental leave, it's often very hard to come back. Now, a lot of workplaces don't have, you know, gender kind of parental leave, equal parental leave for all genders, and they prioritize parental leave for women. So women are more expected to take parental leave than their male partners, for example. So these things come into play. Caring responsibilities, all of these things come into play, which are not necessarily the choice of women, but they come into play in terms of women then eventually deciding to leave those workplaces.
So what's interesting though is if you look at the graphs, love a graph, you know, you've got maybe, yes, okay, more boys are choosing the sciences than girls perhaps, but you know, in those early years, there's they're fairly even. And then, you know, everything's going along quite nicely, but as things get more senior, the men stay and women are choosing to go on and do other stuff. And that's interesting, and that has a really profound impact on leadership in science. Now, you've all made these different... You've faced different realities at different life stages, all of you on this panel. And I'm curious to know where some of the challenges came for you and how you address them. Like, Madhu, you are actually being the change you want to see in your workplace and also in your relationship. And it's setting incredible examples for other people. Tell us a little bit about how you've navigated all those decisions, including parenting.
I was thinking about the pipeline as you were talking about it, right? And I guess that's where there's a little bit of a difference from coming from a country like from India or Asia or China. Like if you look at the graphs, you'll find the number of girls doing STEM in India or in China is actually 50-50.
Yeah.
And leaving is not an option. As harsh as I make that sound, you somehow, you know, you get in there and you have to keep at it because you're paid up front, you've paid the fees up front, so leaving is not an option. So sometimes it's not that you're there because you're passionate about it, but sometimes you're just there because you're into it and you just have to, you know, keep at it and keep going through it. And sometimes that's all you need to do. Like the resilience, I think, or the persistence pays off and you come out of the other end with a degree and with a career. I think that's the biggest difference which I found, you know, coming out from there and coming here and trying to wonder why is it so difficult or why is it so hard. And you grow up, you're never being told that you can't do this. Yeah. Whereas I find there's a lot more chances here of having that conversation where parents or teachers or careers advisors or people you interact with at different points keep telling you, oh, if it's too hard, you don't need to do math. Or if it's too hard, you don't need to do this. I never had the conversation growing up.
No.
And
so you never doubt yourself?
No, because you grew up again in an environment where you see women engineers everywhere, you see women IT professionals everywhere, so you never have that element of self-doubt.
Women are visible.
Visible, everywhere.
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 Yay.
And it's a cultural shift, which I think is actually a lot more harder to achieve in some ways. Like, I love telling the story because my grandmother, for instance, she was educated only till year 8 or something. Before every maths exam, she used to feed me a vegetable which is called okra. And I'm like, why do I need to eat this? She says, no, it sharpens your brain and helps you do maths better. And maths is important. So doesn't take you a PhD to figure out that maths is important in life, right? I mean, there's just this general cultural understanding that maths is important, science is important, being an engineer is a phenomenal job, it's a financially secure position. You are, you know, economically, you'll be stable for life no matter what life throws at you. So it's a very different kind of a scenario. You come here, you get hit with, you know, there's no family support to run to the minute you have a child. I don't think I really felt different until the point of where I had a child, right? So
interesting.
I'm an engineer and I was the only woman in that entire department who was of that childbearing age. I remember when I said I was going to take maternity leave, they said, no one's ever taken maternity leave from engineering in the last 20 years. We actually don't know what to do with you.
No.
And I'm like, okay, wow, okay. And they said, we just don't know. Do we get you a replacement? I'm like, no, there's no replacement for academic staff. So like I said, academia is a very different place to, you know, most other places. So you go and you come back and you realize it's very different. But for me, in some ways, like you said, I was forced to be the change I wanted seen because I just thought, let's just see what happens. I started the Women Researchers Network at RMIT at that point because I came back, realized I have no one to talk to about this. I have a husband who I work with and co-lead the group with. And together and having that partner on your side who is, you know, who exactly understands the challenges, exactly knows what is important, what's not so important, I think is just critically important.
Who's also active in gender equity action.
Yep.
Lucky. And excellent.
Absolutely. And that's one advice I give almost everyone nowadays. The one choice you can make in life, hopefully, is, you know, your life partner. make that a very important choice, because they can be that propeller who just gets you through, you know, your career and life.
Partner with a feminist.
Absolutely.
Yeah, that's interesting. We might come back. Sophie, what about in medicine? Because it's very interesting. It's usually about equal men and women. Stats on non-binary is more complicated and not as available, which is a real shame, and I hope that changes, especially in Australia. Mm. So what's the picture?
I think it's a little bit different, because one of the challenges for science is grants and insecure kind of work don't work with maternity leave. It is much easier as a doctor to take maternity leave. I did get my job changed when I was pregnant, because I thought I might not be up to a certain job, which I found pretty distressing at the time. But
changed your job?
They changed my job. I was supposed to work at the mother-baby unit with pregnant people, and they thought I might not be quite up to it.
Well, because you'd become a mother of a
and
baby.
I might over-identify with the women who are distressed. That judgment was made without having met me or knowing anything about me other than that I was pregnant. So, you know, there's some gender stuff happens all the way through, but in medicine, you can kind of navigate through some of this. It's really hard. I agree with the partner call. I have three children. But I don't even know that having a partner that's a feminist is enough. We had two working medical careers and we are no longer married. So, you know, it's not that he wasn't a feminist, it's that it's really hard. Mm. What I would say for me, the biggest challenge was trying to get a leadership role. Because trying to get a leadership role when you look a bit young and you're a woman, particularly in, I'm going to say, psychiatry kind of privileges age. So the older you look, the more official you are, the more you talk in the sort of, you know, formal way. I think that looks like a leader. I went for lots of job interviews and I got told, you're really great. You'll be really great in about 5 years. Just hold. Cool. Wait. You know, we'll just
say this to
man who's 10 years older than you. No, I don't think so. But, you know, that might be my personality as well. You can't always pull out both things. But, you know, I don't lead exactly like the people before me led. I lead in a more collaborative, inclusive, collective way. I deliberately choose to do that. I'm much more colloquial in my language. I don't sort of sit at the head of the table. I want people to participate, and I consider it a good meeting if everyone else talked. So, you know,
it sounds just human and humane, which you're working in the mental health arena, and we know after COVID, people's mental health has really been very challenged. So humanity is so vital at every phase of a service, isn't it?
Very hierarchical environments.
Environment.
And, you know, it's changing. It's absolutely changing. But I think the challenge, because that scissor graph goes down for women having babies, and then in medicine it goes down again at the leadership point at my age. And I think that is about women trying to get leadership roles or putting their toe in the water and not being successful and perhaps not having the stubborn optimism or persistence to kind of push through and keep insisting. And I can say, if you keep persisting and you keep applying, eventually someone goes, oh, for Christ's sake, give her the job.
Isabelle, what are you finding in your work and analysis of the data? I love good data. And, of course, science is all about collecting good data so we can make informed decisions about the world around us. But what is it telling you about particularly that phase where women are establishing themselves in scientific-related careers and really loving what they're doing and can see a path ahead, and they're really at the peak of their power in many ways. You know, they've done their sort of foundational learning and they're ready to rock. Yeah. What are you seeing happen?
They're leaving. They're leaving, and, yeah, it's causing that graph to kind of, women are down here and women and men are up here, just kind of, you know, as they go towards those leadership roles. There's very, very, very few women. So there's about 20 to 25% of women who are in those leadership roles in science or in STEM in general. So where did they all go?
Well, that's a question, because I think we also often assume that a science degree means you've got to become a scientist. And I just don't think that's true anymore.
That's not true.
We're all about challenging that reality, that science literacy, like learning about science at school and at uni or wherever you happen to go, is really powerful knowledge for all sorts of domains.
You have an engineering degree.
Yeah, weird.
And you're a journalist.
Yeah.
And I have a science degree, and I ended up being a teacher at first. And you can, you know, those skills that you learn in a science degree or in a STEM degree, they can be applied to, they just make you better at absolutely any other career. Because you get those skills where you can think critically, you can solve a problem, you know how to solve a problem. That's what you get from a science degree. You know how to work with other people. You know how to think to make really important decisions. You know how to be creative. All of those things that we've been talking about, you get that from a science degree.
And you're not intimidated by complex information.
No.
And if there was one thing that I got out of doing engineering, I just found that I'm not intimidated by anything I don't understand. And believe you me, I don't understand an awful lot of things. But I find myself, okay, I'm going to interview the Dalai Lama today. Okay, I'm going to understand everything about the mind. You know,
Did
I mean,
you?
Four times. But, you know, I mean, in other words, I just go, okay, I'm just going to do that. And you just go, right. So that's the power of a scientific training for me, is that you're just not intimidated by anything, pretty much.
I'm feeling compelled to come in here. I have a slightly different view.
Excellent.
And
I love
so
that.
And it's based on data. But essentially, once we do manage to get women entering science degrees at university and they graduate and begin to do a PhD, 58% in the medical sciences field, for example, thereabouts, will graduate with a PhD. Very keen, majority women.
Mm.
In your field, majority women, but not at the top. Right? And so it's one of those things where we have to track the different decision points throughout the rest of the academic career, which is what I'm talking about in research.
And some of the decisions are made for you.
Some of the decisions are made for you due to structural and systemic barriers that exist. Okay, so there's everyday sexism, which creeps in. There's us, which creeps in. There's outright discrimination, which still exists. There's also those barriers around childcare, career disruptions, and things like that. All of that impacts career progression going forward. That doesn't stop you from wanting to try and get there. Some people will choose to leave because of the culture or the systemic barriers that may exist within their organisation. It's not everywhere, but a lot of places.
It's in many different sectors too. It's not just science.
It is.
And I don't want to scare the wits out of high school students.
I don't think we do.
I wanted to say this is just life. And actually, some of these challenges can be interesting and to overcome.
I don't think we do scare them, because the beauty is that's what the action's about. It's about shifting those barriers. And it's not about fixing women. It's about fixing science itself and how we do science. I think that's really important that students understand that. Well, that's why we're all here. That's why the parliamentarians are here. And they're super keen to see that go forward. And what's inspiring is that we have shifted where the bottleneck is starting to come. We have shifted it from level B to level C now. So we're hanging on to more women already in certain organisations. That data is starting to come through. That's really exciting. And that gives the whole sector the hope, because it is possible. If they can do it, we can do it. It's also about how we're measuring.
I'm very excited for the next generation coming
through. Oh, same. My daughter's doing science.
There's major change happening in Australia now.
I love the opportunities that lie ahead for her as well. But I think it's important to understand that, you know, we have many factors at play, and it's a very complex story. But I love that women are continuing to pursue science. And if they choose to leave, they're going to have an amazing career somewhere else and do amazing contributions
with an
amazing
knowledge base.
Incredible knowledge base.
I want to focus on solutions, because there is so much stuff happening in Australia and around the world now. And I do think it's a genuine revolution. I think it's a very different time. But Isabelle, you wanted to add a comment.
The solutions.
Yeah.
I wanted
to
talk about the solutions.
Yeah,
that's,
and I also want to come to the audience too. So,
absolutely.
Go for it.
Yeah, so, you know, yes, there are a lot of systemic and cultural barriers. And so to change that, and there's so much going on to that is shifting that, we need that systemic change. And that sounds like a, what are you talking about? What is systemic change? Mm-hmm. But systemic change is essentially just changing the fundamental ways that things are done,
yep.
that people behave, and ultimately that people think, so that the way we work or the way that things are benefit everyone and not just, you know, a small kind of select group of people. So what does that look like? What does that actually mean? A lot of organizations, a lot of places, a lot of people are working on that. So that means, for example, for employers, changing, just recruiting people differently.
Yeah.
Changing the way we recruit people. Changing the way that employees are managed or the entitlements that they have in terms of like leave or flexible work arrangements. How people are promoted. What are the criteria for promotion? What is seen as a valuable leader. Changing the way that people work together and interact with each other and that culture and, you know, removing the harassment or the microaggressions. All those things need to change, and they are slowly in our organizations, in our workplaces, they are changing. People are trying to transform the way that they're trying to address and shift those conditions that are holding those problems in place.
Yeah.
That is systemic change. And it needs to come from every angle. And it's an everybody problem, like we were saying. It's not just the employers.
It's not a woman's problem.
It's not a woman's problem.
Let's be clear about that.
And it's not just the employers. We can't say, well, the employers need to change. Yes, they need to change. But, you know, the funders, you know, in science, the funders play a huge role in that change. Government.
What about Parliament House? What role do you all see for this institution, the Parliament House of Victoria, the Parliament of Victoria, and all the people who work here, the members of Parliament? What role does Parliament House, this esteemed institution, have, this community?
Victoria's inspiring, I think. It's really leading the way on gender equality. So I served on the Council for Women's Equality with the Minister for Women, Fiona Richardson, as well as Natalie Hutchins, which I'm delighted to see is back in that role, and Gabrielle Williamson. And to me, the opportunities that's offered by the Gender Equality Act really set us up for success. So there's a lot of movement already on the Women in STEM initiatives.
So this is a piece of law that
absolutely
demands change.
And it does, and it involves the universities, and it involves government leading, so they now have gender equality on many of their committees and boards. And they have also taken that to the level of chairs, who's chairing those committees, and they're really taking that action and holding others to account. Mm-hmm. And that's such a fantastic initiative that we have here in Victoria. It opens doors, right? And now we just need to get the industry sector on board and doing the same thing, which I believe they will. So I think for women in STEM in Victoria, we're leading the way. We have really cutting-edge institutes that have won Athena Swan Awards. We have engagement with all the Women in STEM Australia, Women in STEM Ambassadors Office. Homeward Bound is just flourishing with alumni from, you know, your programs. And to me, the Australian Academy of Technology and Engineering really values what state governments do. And we are tuned in to what each state government's doing. And Victoria's leading in this space. And so I think parliamentarians, the whole parliamentary friends of science that exists at the federal level, is now mirrored at the state level. That's really exciting. So congratulations on that.
Can we scientists, science-trained people, medically trained people, technologically
engaging
trained
people? With
parliamentarians. Actually, as parliamentarians.
That'd be even better.
Radical concept.
That'd be even better, right? Because we have one right here. And so I think it's an opportunity for us to be doing more together to teach people how to advocate for STEM and women in STEM and diversity in STEM, but also for parliamentarians to engage and have interns who are scientists and learn from them. You wanted to gather information. You mentioned that earlier. You can't know everything, so you need that consultation. We're here. So I think also there's the opportunity then to learn from Parliament and how things work. A lot of people, it's a big black box of decision-making power. Mm. How does it work? And so that's when you do get people who are super excited about it. We have a number of medicos now who are parliamentarians from Victoria, which yes. is extraordinary. And so I think it's really exciting to see that shift happening yeah. as well. And Alan Sandel's one I mentioned.
I love the idea of having science-trained young students coming in amazing. And interning as policy interns inside with MPs, I think, and members of Parliament. I think that just would be marvellous. Mm-hmm. Hey, we've got a room full of people here, and we've got you joining us on the live feed on either the Parliament of Victoria Facebook page or the Parliament of Victoria website, or indeed the Royal Society of Victoria Facebook page. I've got some questions from here, which I'm about to come to, but I'd like to open the mics up on the floor here in this beautiful room here. Any questions from the audience? Yes, I think we do have one here. Thank you. Do you want to come and stand up in front of the mic just so we can hear you?
There's been a lot of talk about systematic changes, but how are we going to tackle biases that we're very unconscious about that still pop up every day?
Yeah, and I think you're studying science?
Yeah.
Or about to start?
About to start the undergraduate course, yes.
Brilliant. Good question. Unconscious bias, just explain what that is and how it operates in our world.
We all have it. So my lived experience would have influenced how I make decisions and see the world around me. And so I was brought up in a primarily white society, so I have less understanding of people from other cultures. And so I may be cautious about that without even realising it. So it's that unconscious bias that may happen, and so you have to constantly identify it and fight against it to learn and unlearn and relearn, and that's the power of the journey of allyship.
Yeah. And the good news from brain science is that you can change it. You can. It does get altered. So the more you admire the problem, the more you notice it, the more you see it, the more you make a conscious desire to do it differently, you won't get rid of it straight away, and I don't think any of us can get rid of all of it, but you can chip away at it, and it absolutely, I think, you know, it's, you can't be what you can't see, so you need to see people in those roles, and then you need to question yourself, and sometimes when you're a leader and you have a female leader yourself, you think, why is she, and you think, wait a minute, I have to just stop and check myself. Am I unconsciously treating her like my mother? And is that fair? And would I do that to someone else? And then make a more reflective, thoughtful decision about how I feel about them. So we all have to do it all the time. And all I think anything that helps modelling and visibility and anything that highlights unconscious bias. And, you know, one of the things we have done in our selection criteria for Homeward Bound actually is to try and get all the people
just to remind people what Homeward Bound is. It's a leadership program for women in the sciences. Yep. They go to Antarctica, but also learn and foster leadership skills for themselves.
And it's global. So we have lots of cultural biases that come in when we look at people's interview, their CVs, and they do a little video. And it's really hard to take away that unconscious bias you have about other cultures that you don't know so well. Mm-hmm. So we try and get all the selectors to go through and do some unconscious bias training, do the little questionnaires that are freely available on the internet, just to remind themselves before they start rating people that this is probably going to be enacted, and to double check their thinking when it comes to someone from a culture that's not the same as theirs.
And Isabelle, there are ways of that workplaces are doing things like They're stripping the gender from CVs on job applications.
Yes.
And so that people who are on selection panels, and let's hope that those selection panels are diverse themselves, they don't know the gender of the applicant.
Yeah, so they remove the gender, they remove the first and last names, actually. Mm. So they do, you know, people do that for job applications. We're actually at our office, we're working with 4 big research organizations like CSIRO and we've removed, we were doing an experiment where we've removed the names of the scientists who are applying for research resources like time on telescopes or on supercomputers to see if it's going to have an impact on who gets those resources. NASA did it a few years ago, and they had, once they removed the names of the scientists, more women got more time on the Hubble telescope than before. And they were just blown away, so they have continued doing that. So you write a grant application for NASA, your name is not on it, so you will not be judged as whoever you are, but just as your, like, what you can do.
It's very powerful, so it's not just our own unconscious biases, it's the system that we can strip it from the system. Question, we had more hands up. Yes, thank you.
My question is about what is almost a conscious bias, and that's what's called the last acceptable form of discrimination, which is ageism. We know it's huge in STEM from surveys in Europe and in the US. It comes only second to gender in terms of barriers to diversity and inclusion. We know we've got that intersectionality, that women get hit with ageism earlier and harder, but we don't seem to be tackling it head on and even calling it out very often. And also, can I just say, it's one of those, it's a really difficult thing to manage if you're talking about biases on cultural and gender, and you can hide names. You can't hide experience. Okay, it's a double-edged sword. If you hide your experience to hide your age, you don't get the job because you don't have the experience. So I think it's a colossal problem. I think it's a problem for women like me and some other women in the room who are in the last quarter of their career. I also think it's a problem for women entering STEM. And I've seen this with young women. They seem to really value those older women particularly. I'm not quite sure why, but I've really seen that happen.
Work when you can be deemed too young, you can be deemed too old.
Correct.
Ridiculous, yes. Isn't it?
It's crazy, but I think we're losing a lot of women that we can't afford to lose. It's just totally wrong, I think, is the other thing, and the wisdom that's being lost. Okay, and we talk a lot about, or we've talked, and I've really enjoyed this so much, but we've talked a lot about choices women make. And I do think I'm just not sure that those choices are real. And I look at my own career and it's gone. Da 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 da, glass ceiling, move over. Da 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 da, glass ceiling, move over. You know, and it's been great fun, but I wouldn't say those choices were forced upon me. I've made the best of them, but you know. Yeah. But thank you.
That's a really powerful question. Thank you for asking it, and so vital. Any thoughts?
I thought it was really interesting. You said that it's kind of flipped, because the more esteemed you get, the more respect you have.
We're weird in psychiatry. It's not like that everywhere else.
Not the case in laboratory science, definitely.
But particularly in Australia, ageism is rife. It's
everywhere, unfortunately.
I feel like people get a hard go.
Don't you think it's that link, though, for women particularly, that's about appearance and age,
and
that is sort of, you know, in our minds entwined, where we just judge women a little bit more harshly. We have different expectations for women than men in every way. I think it comes down to our primary attachment figure, like our mother, and we often have stronger expectations of our mother's behaviour, kindness, empathy, but also appearance. And I think appearance and age are so intimately linked. And we just judge women on what they look like. And hence, I think we're all wearing black I wear black partly because it means that I'm not being judged on what I'm wearing. I'm being judged on what I'm saying. And I don't know if that's the same for you guys.
Yeah.
But I think that appearance is a really big thing for women, and that is so linked to age. I do work in a field that's completely different, where the older and more haggard you are, the better a leader you're assumed to be, but that's just like...
It's a little bit like that in academia too, but Madhu, how do you navigate that? Because you've become a really incredible leader. You were starting to show leadership potential very early in your career. And so how did you navigate that? Did you cop ageism?
I think so. And funnily enough, I don't think I copped it until I actually attempted to become a leader. So funnily enough, they were happy for me to keep going through the academic ranks, and I could apply for promotions, become an associate professor, but the minute you wanted to start becoming probably more of a leader, then, you know, you kind of looked too young, wrong gender, wrong culture, whatever. So I'm not quite sure which one of it played against me, or probably all three as a combination. Mm-hmm. Or maybe it's my blabbermouth. I'm not sure. But
I love your blabbermouth. Never stop.
You call out things, and sometimes your personality doesn't help, right? So, and no, you're right. Because and it's the same thing in terms of getting PhD students, right? It's kind of the opposite for us, where I found a lot more PhD students were navigating to the people who looked older, who had more experience. I really struggled to get students in the initial stage because they were like, no, you look like a PhD student yourself. What do you know about doing a PhD? Whereas now I feel I'm getting a lot more PhD students, and that's also because of the title. So, you know, a lot of tiny things play up in people's minds. I was going to actually make this point earlier, which was along, like, we have a center of excellence, and we have only 4 women chief investigators within that. The remaining 11 of them are men. And we are trying to get, you know, and it's a center in physics and engineering, so it's pretty representative of numbers in physics and engineering. 30% is actually a very healthy number. But when we were trying to recruit women, we found all the women postdocs or PhD students were just navigating towards those 4 women. The 11 men were not getting any kind of women students, no matter how hard they tried.
Well, that says so much.
It just happens automatically. And they were just, the same ad was sitting over there, but all the women were just channeling and coming towards us, and there was hardly anyone going towards the men. And so it kind of somehow, you know, kind of just reiterates the point of, if you see them, you can be them. And so, you know, they kind of feel that, okay, I feel more comfortable there. And so somehow for me, it just kind of felt, if we put more and more women and more diversity into the system, we will attract more and more women and more diversity in the system. And hopefully the problem will resolve itself in, say, 2 decades, 3 decades. I don't know, still feels too long. But it is really the case of having more people to attract more people who look like them and feel like them and think like them. I don't know, it's just like an eye-opener in some ways.
And more women in leadership. And Ali on the Parliament of Victoria Facebook page says, what do you think would help women overcome these barriers to leadership and remain in the sciences? Do you require a cultural shift? How might that be achieved? I mean, so what fundamental change needs to have to happen from your perspective as a scientific leader for women to progress into leadership roles in, say, engineering?
There was one thing which we did at RMIT, which was done like a trial, but then now is, you know, being just rolled out, which we call achievement relative to opportunity. And it's basically the situation of where you apply for a job, you apply for promotion, you're kind of treated as the same as a person who has a similar number of years in their career or has had a very similar thing coming into the career. There's no place in most job applications or promotion applications to state what your life has been like. And this is not a gendered thing. It could be applicable to all genders, in my opinion.
Yeah.
You might have had a life-changing situation, but there's nowhere in that application to actually capture it. It's a very simple thing.
The richness is.
Absolutely.
You know, isn't it?
Absolutely.
To hear those stories from potential applicants is like, wow, this is the person I need to know and work with.
We did that first in promotions. So we did that in promotion because we found the people were just comparing it as, this is an associate professor and this is an associate professor, and they've both been associate professors for 3 years, which means they are exactly the same. But then once you add this extra one page of, but tell me what else has happened since you last became promoted, the stories start, you know, coming out. And then you start realizing that actually they're not exactly the same. They're actually quite different. So we kind of picked that up and put it in recruitment as well. And again, it was an eye-opener because there were people who were trying to break away from industry and enter academia. Or there were people who were trying to come from government and enter academia. And there was nowhere to capture that story of what, this is what my life looked like. Or I've moved countries and therefore, you know, this is the kind of career interruptions I've faced. I had a life debilitating illness that year and this is what, how it actually changed or impacted me.
Or I've been caring for my mother or my child or
Absolutely.
Foster because child.
We focus a lot on career interruption, and career interruption somehow just became equivalent to maternity leave for a very long time. But there are more career interruptions in life than just maternity leave. And so for me, it was a valuable, valuable way of just capturing what life has thrown at people's ways, but how that's actually enriched you, and therefore what's that life experience you're going to bring into that either leadership position or the job you're applying for.
We have seen the same thing in our Elevate Women in STEM, Boosting Women in STEM scholarships that are funded by the federal government. So undergraduates, postgraduate researchers and leaderships all can apply for these scholarships. And so if you're in senior high school, please look out for them. We did the story thing. We simplified the application and we're not basing it on academic merit. As long as you get enrolled, you're good to go. We also shifted, we have 65 amazing assessors who all wanted to support this program. They just immediately put their hand up. And they were so inspiring because they came with us on the journey of taking an equitable approach to peer review. So we often, you know, have a very merit-focused kind of approach to how we assess applications. And we'll say, oh, this one has an award and this one has done this, and so therefore they're notched up a little higher. We didn't do that. We said, look at the stories. Look at this, and if you have two people who are the same, who is the more disadvantaged due to background or some other reason? And they were the ones who were notched up a little higher. We reached every diversity target in this first year. We had more than 1,000 applications, 973 went through, and we had 50 scholarships to give out. It was the most painful assessment period. No, genuinely, it hurt.
Yeah,
because so many good students were brilliant, and we're so pleased to have really achieved
that's
that.
That's the Elevate program, Torres Strait Islander. So you know. Elevate Google, and yes, we have another question here. Thank you.
Please.
When you said Elevate, I thought, this is the moment for my question. Gillian Sparks. Thank you, everyone. Fantastic panel.
Gillian Sparks is the Commissioner for Environmental Sustainability
in
Victoria.
Yep. I am. Thank you, Natasha. What I wanted to ask was, and thinking of Elevator, with our problem-solving scientific brains, if you get the opportunity to get into an elevator with the Minister for Education, so I'm talking prep to Year 12 now, what would be the one thing that you would ask that person to do to attract and retain more women and girls into STEM careers?
Yeah, great. And can I add Rosalie's question to that one? What would be your best piece of advice for a second-year teacher, I'm assuming that's you, Rosalie, trying to inspire diversity and inclusion in science, working in a high school? What advice would you give the students? These are the teaching students. Isabelle.
The best piece of advice... And I truly, truly think that this is what education in general is missing. We are so focused on grades. We are so focused on standardized tests. What we need to focus on is what the students are learning and that they're actually getting the experience to do the real stuff. So to teachers out there who are listening, get your students to do real science, actual science, not learning it from a textbook. I know that, you know, there's constraints, but actually getting them to do authentic science and understand what the nature of science is, that, you know, science as a human endeavor. That's what we need to teach young people, to get them to want to do science and attract them into those science careers, especially girls. There's research out there that shows that they're more drawn to subjects that have relevance to everyday life and to society. And
which is the case.
World. Changing the world. And so coming back to what you were saying earlier. Yeah.
I mean, my experience was that a lot of boys, when I was involved in a women in engineering unit up in Sydney at one point, the boys were desperate for that contextual, you know, real-world applications, real-world examples, a sense of a social story around their practice, almost as much as the young women were. It was interesting.
Yeah. So, like, why are we learning this? You know, students ask that all the time. Miss, sir, why are we learning this? That's what needs to be brought in, and then actually doing that thing rather than just learning facts.
Yeah, great point.
Can I add one thing?
Yeah, Sophie.
Some experiences of awe, because and you talked about going out to the desert and we take people to Antarctica, when we have awe, we open that curiosity and creativity and we think differently about who we are and we see ourselves in a different perspective and we sort of want to dedicate our life to something bigger. So a bit of awe needs to be in there.
Yeah.
Could I come back to the minister in the elevator? I would really encourage the minister to consider initiatives that support teachers, because teachers are teaching STEM, some of them, like Isabelle, may not have had that research experience, and yet they have to teach inquiry-based learning. So we sell kits to help teachers do that, but some may get a kit and they'll say, how do I use this? Mm. How do I teach this lesson? So we have to provide that professional development, and we're very keen to do that as an academy. That's what we want to do, is upskill teachers. But they need so much more. And I've done surveys where they ask for leadership, for communication, for connection as peers, particularly if they're an out-of-field teacher trying to teach STEM. So they're a geography teacher who's teaching STEM. Many, many, many classes, over 40% in STEM, are taught by teachers out of field. Mm-hmm. It has dramatically increased.
They don't have science training.
They don't. Mm-hmm. And that, to me, is a really big thing that we can support.
I'd like to see a fundamental shift in how we teach science because, you know, you'll go and learn about global politics and world history, and then you'll go and you'll do a little exercise with some straws in the science class. And same so in engineering. Sorry. I did that in engineering.
Yeah. It's like, and that's okay, and in some schools,
North-South politics class, and then I'd come back and learn about surface tension in engineering. Yep. And I needed the engineering to be in this bigger global social political context. It's there everywhere.
But I'm thinking of the school that's got 12 students in North Eaton. Straws may be all they have.
Exactly.
Right?
And Teresa asked, should we set up STEM labs in regional areas, not just in cities?
Let's do it.
Can I just go back to the minister on the elevator? With my engineering hat on, I would love it if they can actually decouple. I love that the fact it's now already decoupled and it's STEM. It's not just science. Everything doesn't get banned as science. Decouple engineering into the various branches of engineering. The biggest stereotype I would love to break is that an engineer is a man in a hard hat. And that's the only picture which comes up the minute you Google engineer. You have a civil engineer with a hard hat. There's so much more to engineering than just civil engineering. And so for me to break down that would be phenomenal. The second thing which I would love them to do is scream a little more about STEM as much as they scream about sports people, perhaps. I feel like they get a lot more of the just the clout and just the amount of, you know, attention and the spotlight. If the spotlight could also be shared by people in STEM, we wouldn't have crossed a pandemic without people in STEM and working in all aspects of STEM, the S, the T, the E, and the M, and the M. So if the spotlight could be on those contributions.
And I think have engineering in schools? Because a lot of schools don't even have
it. I think it just
it.
Elevates.
Yeah. No. We've got some questions in the audience, and I want to make sure I get to you all. Thank you. And then I'll come to you.
I just wanted to add to what we were speaking about, the minister in the elevator. I believe that strengthening teachers through informal education support is something what I would like to, you know, present as my viewpoint, that there are lots of expertise in the community who straight away don't want to go into teaching and straight away don't want to, you know, step up into academic roles. If the minister's got open ears and, you know, some policies in place, like US and like other developed nations have encouraged informal education, could be along the creeks, could be along, you know, outside the education system. I believe that's something that needs to be viewed and taken further.
Really getting people who are working in real jobs, real industries, real scientists, actually liaising with the earlier generations.
And it also comes as, you know, not someone who's got a tag on them that I have worked as a scientist in so-and-so organisation. It could be people like overseas migrants having, you know, tertiary qualifications but not served for an organisation. So it could be these common people meeting at community places, houses, and, you know, encouraging STEM in all ages. So that's where I believe is also one of the ways of tackling the problem of, you know, dealing with how we can strengthen STEM workforce and take it further through education.
I love that. That's really about building a kind of whole culture of learning and conversation about knowledge, isn't it? Thank you very much for that point. Thanks. A question over here.
Hi, I agree that the conversation around how do we get girls into STEM is very, very important. But when you go through STEM, there's kind of that pipeline, that tunnel, and you kind of just see academia as your only option when you're going through. But, you know, we want women to be scientists, but also science journalists in education, in advocacy. So how do we support women in academia and keep them there, but also have lots of women who are STEM qualified in lots of other jobs, because there seems to kind of be this mass exodus?
Yeah, that's right. Celebrate. I want to come to those answers, but I'll come back, and I just want to grab a couple of questions in a row if I can, just because time is with us, so thank you. But hold that thought.
Hi, I'm Ritika, thanks. I just had a question. So we've heard that finding a supportive partner is a very good life advice, and I've heard that in this room, I've heard that in the past, and I wonder, are men being given the same advice? And then secondly, while I think that this is a great intermediate strategy, how do we as a society build infrastructure that doesn't make your warpath easier by finding a supportive partner? It just makes it easier because you're you.
I hear you, sister. That's brilliant. And we had another question there, I think. Thank you.
Thank you. Just going back to the discussion about teachers and how science is taught in high schools, I think I totally agree that for a lot of teachers, there's through professional development, they can expand their repertoire. But science teachers, or teachers in general, operate in a system that increasingly, you already mentioned the pressure of grades and the emphasis on grades. That pressure is actually increasing. There's NAPLAN, mm-hmm. there's VCE, there's ATAR, and there's a massive push these days towards what's called direct instruction, quoting evidence that is the best way that students learn in terms of getting high grades. Mm-hmm. So that is totally opposite to the way that I would like to, that you're advocating, and that also I would like to see science to be taught in ways that are more genuine to the nature of science, and probably also more motivating for students generally, but maybe girls more specifically. So there's a big tension, and I'm not sure. So we should also be careful to say, well, teachers should do things differently, but teachers operate in a system where there's pressure from principals, from parents.
Are you a science teacher?
I'm a science educator at the University of Melbourne.
Yeah, yeah.
And also from governments. So it's a complex problem that I think needs to be addressed, not just putting pressure on teachers alone, but seeing how they operate in the ecosystem that they work in.
And there's a sort of irony there, isn't there? Because NAPLAN and all those things, it's all about data and data collection and measuring, and that's kind of science at work, isn't it? If we don't know, we need to know what's out there and what the needs are in order to, you know, better serve students. But in fact, it can kind of kill the joy. Somewhat.
Yeah. I mean, that's why I left teaching, because I didn't like the ecosystem, and I said, I don't want to teach like this, so I'm going to go teach in a museum where I can teach the way I want to teach.
Yeah.
So it is tough.
Did you want to add a thought? Just stand up in front of that mic.
I'm just going to add a thought about the pipeline metaphor, because it sort of brings up the hairs on my skin a little bit, because I think it's quite a dangerous metaphor, because it implies one line. When you're out of that line, you're out. So I think we need to think about more complex ways of imagining the sorts of ways that people can come in, go out, so that not once you're in, you're stuck in, or you drop out and you're out. So let's kind of do one thing more simply in terms of changing things by changing the metaphor as well.
The London Underground.
Yes. So that's really interesting, though, because it comes back to the point that the person up here made about, why can't we let multiple career paths bloom in this science ecosystem? Once you've done some scientific training, actually it should be kind of implicit in that training that you might lead many different lives, and it might not just be going into a lab, yeah?
I just want to say the data's only as good as the question you ask. And what we're doing when we do the pipeline is we're just evaluating the people that stay, and we're not having methods to capture what other people are doing and the richness of their job. So I think it's a little bit our initial hypothesis that's the problem, really, in terms of seeing the pipeline. Mm-hmm. And maybe that's a really good call to arms to start thinking about how we evaluate what women in science do and what they contribute, and maybe what they contribute is far more than we're currently seeing, because we didn't ask the right question.
question.
Ah, that's so potent. So we had a number of questions. That question, we also had a question about, well, why do we assume... Oh, you had a question too. Oh, come on down. Yeah, sorry.
Hi, my name is Cindy. I'm a STEM influencer and I'm a first-generation student. Recently finished my PhD. But a lot of...
Congratulations.
Thank you. A lot of my followers ask me the same question on a daily basis, which is how can they navigate their academic journey? And I feel like the education system that is set up how do I describe this? It doesn't take into account a lot of the minority populations, such as those that first generation or from a different background from like myself. And so I came into the academic journey kind of needing to navigate it myself. So I was wondering what support out there is in structure for students like myself to get to leadership roles that they would like to or aspire to get.
Apply for Homeward Bound.
Apply for an elevator.
Apply for lots of these things because a lot of them are really focused on young people and also mentoring from older women. And I think that's kind of what you kind of need is to see someone else who's done it and to have that mentoring capacity to talk to them.
It's also about immersing you within a network of leaders and organisations that we work with already toward inclusion and diversity. And so it's about more than just the scholarship or giving you the money or just the program and applying. It's about what you're surrounded in that community and how you are then carried throughout your career, which is definitely what we want to do. We want undergrads to become leaders and then we want them to become fellows of the academy, hopefully. And so I think it's that pastoral support, that pastoral care and support that's underneath. And so we want to work with universities on how we can do that more effectively, particularly for Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander students, because we would love to see them complete their degrees and move up into leadership. And so that's something we're deeply immersed in, and we're trying to expose every scholar to the breadth of STEM careers that are out there across every sector, because you're right, it's not only that our education system's quite biased towards the white privileged pathway, which we know is the case for a lot of our lecturers, that's where they've come from.
And people whose parents went to university,
but it's academia,
et cetera.
It's very academic focused.
Yeah. What about the question of this reliance? Thank you so much for your question. And I'm fascinated that you're a STEM influencer.
Yeah.
So is this on TikTok or Instagram or something like that? Oh, good, we'll check it.
Fantastic.
So how do we follow you?
It's called The Scholar Diaries.
The Scholar Diaries, thank you. You'll get a big little crowd joining you. The question about why do we assume that people need to have a supportive partner or a supportive household, supportive parents, you know, we have these sorts of assumptions that, but what if you're just trying to make your way in the world without those sorts of supports?
We're none of us islands. And I think that comes back to the network that Homeward Bound do, and it sounds like you guys are doing. And I keep wanting to chime in, and wellbeing for teachers, and wellbeing for the leaders, and wellbeing and people being looked after in all sorts of ways. Because the happier and the more connected we all are, the better we all do our jobs and the more inclusive we are. So I know we've got to do all this structural stuff, but we also have to do structural stuff that looks after and cares for people, because then they do a much, much better job of all the other stuff.
Can I just chime in there and say it doesn't have to be only a supportive partner, but you need some support. Now, it can be a parent, it could be an in-law, like my mother-in-law is the most supportive. It could be a partner, it could be a massive friends network who are there to lift you up and cheerlead you and carry you through every time you feel down. But you just need some kind of a support in that network. And I used to be asked this question all the time, who's your role model, who's your mentor? I didn't have one. I don't have a role model, I don't have a mentor. So not everything is necessary. I think there are 300 or 500 ways to become successful in life, and not everything is applicable to every single person. But it's just, when you can hopefully surround yourself with the right people who will propel you or push you in the right direction, hopefully you can do that.
Yeah, just think of any challenging time you've ever had in your life and what helped you get through that challenging time. It's always, you know, the people that you surrounded with yourself with at that time.
And what about, just a final comment on the situation that secondary teachers find themselves in. And if you are a secondary teacher in the room or watching on the live feed, I think you are doing the most important job. Primary and secondary school teachers, you are doing the most... you are all doing important work, but you are actually doing the most important work. It's absolutely foundational. Early childhood education, primary school and secondary education, you have my heart. But thoughts about that? What can we do to empower teachers to have joy in their work, which is what they're there for?
Yeah.
They're not just ticking boxes, you know?
Well, I mean, they are. They are.
Yes.
Unfortunately, they are. So, yeah, you're right. It was a little bit kind of an oversight to say teachers, you know, teachers could be doing this or could be doing that, because I know firsthand that their hands are tied. So essentially, you know, it goes beyond what the teachers can do. To education needs to literally be not just shaken, but like taken and poured out, and we need to start fresh. And that's in Australia, that's in Canada, where I'm from, that's like in a lot of pretty much everywhere. We need a huge shakeup of education and how we teach young people. The world has changed exponentially, and education has remained the same, and it's a disaster. So I actually don't know what teachers can do except for yell.
It's
for
not
change.
Too much of a disaster, because we do have some fantastic high school students in here, and I'm really delighted that you're here. I hope we haven't put you off anything. Just know that there are incredible people that are there to back you every step of your way, you know? And there are networks of incredible women and girls who have each other's back. You know, it's through the friendships and the relationships that we can fully empower our life stories and our career pathways in the sciences. Like, that's where the power lies. And I think that women and girls and non-binary people are particularly powerful at relationships often. So I think we had one. You can squeeze it in. It's got to be 10 seconds. No, okay. Look, it's been my delight to have this conversation with you. Thank you so much for bringing the wealth of life experience and knowledge and insights, and all of you are interrogating the issues and looking for powerful ways to change the situation and actually changing the situation, so that when we all went through, we faced some challenges. The next generation coming through, it's so exciting what's coming. And I'm just delighted that you've all been here. So I want to thank our wonderful panel, Maggie Evans-Galea, Isabelle Kingsley, Madhu Bhaskaran and Sophie Adams. Thank you so much. I want to thank our Facebook Live audience for joining us today. Thank you for your questions throughout. And, of course, today has been recorded. It's going to be edited up and put together, and it'll be beautiful. And you'll have it on the Royal Society of Victoria's website, one of our co-hosts, and also I think the Parliament of Victoria will put it up on their website too, our co-host. And I also want to thank the Victorian Parliamentarians for STEMM. Tim Reid, thank you so much for being here today. Really appreciate that as an MP. The Commissioner for Environmental Sustainability Victoria, thank you so much for being here, Commissioner. Really grateful to have your support and for enabling this event, and for Inspiring Victoria, who I think funded the event as well. So thank you so much for that. And thank you all for coming into this beautiful space. Isn't it a precious thing to be able to see an environment like this? And let's help the Parliament shake things up too, because decision makers live here and work here, and they can actually make legislative change that enables all sorts of pathways for all people. So, thank you. Thank you. Thank you for your questions.